395, in my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. Let's all stand together as we go to 395. I have a song that Jesus gave me. Let's sing that together. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody.
Singing this morning. Good to see everybody in church today. And how many of you stayed up later than what you should have last night watching a football game? Yeah, that's what I thought. And but a good win for the Buckeyes last night in Oklahoma. And it's still the Lord's Day. Amen. And good to see you. What a great conference we've had. Just been wonderful every single night. And last night was tremendous. And looking forward to today. I was telling Brother Reed this morning, you know, it seems like we just started. It seemed like Brother Burden just talking about the watchman on the wall and warning people. And Brother Cobb was telling us about Hannah praying for Samuel. And that was all Thursday night. And here we are Sunday already. It goes by so quickly, and it's been a delightful time. Glad you're here this morning. Thank you for being in church today, and let's pray together and ask God to meet with us, all right? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you for another Lord's Day that you brought us to. Lord, thank you for the song you have put in our heart. Yes. For truly in our heart there rings a melody that came to us when Jesus Christ gave us salvation. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. And, Lord, I pray if any in the room today has never come to know Christ as their Savior, that today would be that day. Would they understand that they're a sinner who needs a Savior and that Jesus is a Savior they need. I pray you'll be pleased with our service today. We pray that Christ will be exalted and that he'll be lifted up and that all men can be drawn unto him. So, Lord, may you be pleased with everything that's said and done here this morning. Use the service, Lord, to accomplish your will in each one of our lives. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Lord of sea and sky. I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in darkest sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Here is I, Lord. I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their heart of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, where you lead me.
Let's go to joy unspeakable and full of glory. I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. On that first together. I have found his grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, free as free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half has never yet been told. I have found the pleasure I once craved. It is joy and peace within. What a wondrous blessing. And full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half has never yet been told. Let's sing that last. I have found the joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roll. It is like a great o'erflowing well, springing up within my soul. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. Oh, the half has never yet been told.
listen carefully now. We have some announcements for you. There's no 5:30 Christian Growth class this evening because of our conference, and it'll resume next Sunday night. But we will, 6:30 tonight, be back for the evening service, all right? That's the closing service of the conference. That's always a great time together. And don't miss Sunday night tonight. You will enjoy the service and the final service of our conference for 2016. All right? And then a couple things to take note of in your bulletin. Next Sunday, Brother Hector Jimenez will be with us. Excuse me. Brother Hector has conducted the trips into Mexico down with Bearing Precious Seed that we go on, and he's been the preacher. When you go in and you set up for the service in the evenings, Brother Hector brings the message there. He's been doing that for how many years, Brother Bob? Do you know? About 20 years maybe. And I'm thinking probably somewhere sees 2,000 to 3,000 people saved every summer. Been doing that for 15 years. Just amazing, wonderful man, humble man, servant of the Lord, and he's back for the missions conference down at First Baptist Church in Milford, and I wanted to ask him when I was out there to make sure when he comes back to our area to come up and see us, and so he'll be with us, and he'll be speaking for us on Sunday evening, but his family will be with us during the day. Looking forward to having many of you folks be able to meet him, and those of you who've been on the missions trip, you'll get to see him again, and that'll be next Sunday, all right? Also, don't forget on the 27th, Brother Moreland, 1040 International, will be having the Lunch and Learn Conference, all right? Pastor Garrick from Armenia will be here. He's got a number of other pastors and missionaries. Brother Tim Cleghorn will be here to speak during that conference. And it'll be a great, great time. Is Brother Troll going to be here, too? He'll be here speaking about the mindset of Muslims and how to witness to Muslims. And so he'll be speaking on that. It'll be a great, great day. 9 to 3, and we're going to give you lunch, okay? And so we need to know you're coming. That'll help us know how to prepare for the meal. And so please let Brother Moreland know if you're planning on being here that day, and I encourage you to come. That'll be a great Tuesday here, September 27th. Now, we have to make sure you understand something in the bulletin. Do you see it talks about the bonfire at the Manning Farm next Saturday, the 1st of October? Somebody says, well, next Saturday isn't October 1st. No, that's considered, I'm told that's considered this Saturday. So the Saturday coming is called this Saturday. Next Saturday would be the 1st. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I feel a wave of disbelief, Brother Bob, over that. Well, he said that is grammatically correct, that this Saturday would be September 24th. And so this Saturday, the 24th, the teens are having a game night, and that's at the church, and it's free, no charge, from 4 to 7 p.m., okay? You should bring some chips or something to drink, okay? So teens, game night, so if that's not this Saturday, when is it? It's this Saturday, isn't it? Okay, this Saturday coming up. And, man, the 24th, okay? The bonfire and hayride is next Saturday. I think it's a week from Saturday. That'll be all right, okay? No, it's 2 weeks from yesterday. Okay, are y'all confused now? October 1st, how's that? Okay, October 1st. That's sign up for that downstairs. That was a great time last year out at the Manning Farm. Great spot, and get to park and ride the hay wagon out to the bonfire. It's a great time together. So sign up for that. We'll have a great time together on October the 1st, okay? All right, now let's take a moment, and we'll welcome our guests that are with us in the service. If you're visiting today and you're not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, we'd love to meet you and find out who you are and where you're from. So if you're visiting this morning or you brought a guest with you, would you honor us by standing? We can find out who you are and where you're from. All right? Right over here.
I'm Angelique Lowe, and this is Betty Griffin, and I'm her daughter.
All right. Good to see you, Angela. Great. Well, good to have you this morning. Wonderful. Amen. That's great. Good to see you today. Thank you for coming. All right. Lydia? Caitlin, good to have you this morning. Thank you for being here. Great. Good to have you in church. Thank you. The usher is going to get you a visitor's card here in just a moment. They're right in that room, Brother Pete. Brother Dean's waiting for you. Okay, and he'll get you those and get you set up. Here he comes. We appreciate you taking a minute and filling out the welcome card. It's right there. All right. And you just come around this way, Pete, a little shorter, and get one over here to Caitlin. Give you a card as well, Caitlin. You can fill out. So we'll have a record of your visit with us. And then we ask you to just put that card in the offering plate in a little bit. We have an offering. And keep the pen as our gift to you for coming this morning. We're glad you're here. Let's give our guests a warm welcome, shall we?
.285 What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. 285, let's sing that first together. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. I'm leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. as we sing that last together, children, you're dismissed to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Let's sing that last. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Amen. That's great singing this morning. Let's go to 492, if you would. 492. When you find that, if you'll stand with me, Jesus Christ has made to me all I need, all I need. Let's sing that first all together. Jesus Christ has made to me all I need, all I need. He alone is all my plea. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness and power, holiness is very arm. My redemption full and free, He is all I need. He redeemed me when He died, all I need, all I need. I with Him was crucified, He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this barrier. My redemption full and free, He is all I need. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very hour. My He's all I need. Let's sing that third together. He's the treasure of my soul. All I need, all I need. Did you find your seats on that third? He's the treasure of my soul. All I need, all I need. He hath cleansed and made me whole. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very hour. My redemption, full and free, He is all I need. Hope you still have your hymnal open, 492. Ladies, would you sing that fourth together? Jesus. Now, wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very hour. My redemption, full and free, He is all I need. As we sing this last, men, I'm going to have us sing the last, and we get to the chorus. Ladies, join us and have the instruments drop out. All right, on that last together, men. Glory, glory to the Lamb. All I need, all I need. By His Spirit sealed I am. He is all I need. All together. Wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness, this very hour. My redemption, full and free, He is all I need.
Amen. Good singing. You may be seated. The ushers will come and they'll receive our offering now this morning. And we'll do not put your faith promise card in the offering, okay? We'll take a special offering after the service just to collect the cards, okay? So this is just for your normal tithe and offering, and we'll collect the faith promise cards at the end of the service. We'll pass the plate for you to put that card in, okay? And appreciate you doing that. Hope you, anybody not have a card and you need a card, you didn't bring one with you, okay? There's a couple here. Can we get somebody to jump up and do that? Bob's coming. Okay, want you to have one. Just keep your hand up until Bob gets you one. There's two ladies right there, Bob. One down here. Okay. Coleman right behind you then. Over here, Melinda. Andy's got Melinda right behind you, Melinda. There you go. Thank you, fellas. Appreciate you doing that. And you'll have that when we collect them and you put the amount in there that God wants you to give in the next year for missions, okay? All right, let's pray for offering this morning, shall we? Brother Wallace, lead us in our prayer, please.
Father, it's been a joy to be in your house in these last few days and be able to hear about going to other parts of the world to spread your word. Lord, it's very important, but we need your help. So, Lord, lay on our hearts what you would have each one of us to do. And, Lord, lay on our pastor's heart what you would want us as a church to do. And Father, I just pray now that everything that we do and say here will be glorifying to you. Bless the offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
One of the blessings has been having the Inman family with us, and they've been in Thailand for a little over 7 years. Brother and Miss Inman sang for us the other night, and I want them to come back and sing for you this morning. So they're going to sing for us, and then Brother Cobb's going to preach, okay? Are you set? Here they come, and they're bringing harmony with them. Good.
Ask and it shall be given, seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you, opened in God's time. Ye have not, because ye ask not, so ask and seek and find. For the Lord gives good things in his time. Wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord, wait, I say, wait on the Lord, your God. Wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord, wait, wait, wait upon the Lord. Jong call out Jadai, Jong call out Jad Pope, Jong call out Jad Bahagatan, Nai Wei La Praja, Tan Mai Mi, Prab Mai Dai Ka, Jong call and Halat Pope. Pra pra ja pra tan yung ki hai ga tan. Ra kui pra ja, ra kui pra ja, ra kui pra yesu pra ja kong tan. Ra kui pra ja. Ra koi praja, ra 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 koi pra Yesu. Wait, wait, wait upon the Lord.
Okay, I have enjoyed this conference. It's been such a blessing to be here each evening. And the theme of the conference, you see it on that banner back there, how shall they hear? The rest of the verse says, without a preacher. It's a, what we call a rhetorical question. The answer is obvious. They can't. How shall they hear without a preacher? We were discussing just real briefly what they need to hear. They need to hear that they are in danger of perishing, but that God doesn't want them to perish. We need to tell them that Jesus has died for their sins. We're going to talk about that more this morning, but the Bible says that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. The price has been paid for everyone. And then we mentioned that we need to tell them that God wants to save them. He loves them. The Bible says that He desires that all men would be saved. And finally, just one other little thought this morning is that we need to tell them that God commands them to be saved. He commands them to repent. Acts 17 and verse 30 says that God commandeth all men everywhere to repent. But they cannot repent or believe without a preacher. So how shall they hear? And that's what we're discussing during this mission conference. How can we get missionaries out there so they can tell the people? And that's what we are dealing with. And one important part of that, of course, prayer is the most important part. But besides that, our missionary giving enables the missionaries to go and live and stay and preach to people that need to hear. And so it's so very important. If God doesn't want you to go personally, you can help send somebody else. Amen. Let's turn in our Bibles this morning to First Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. What are we taking to the people? We're taking the gospel. Now, you would be surprised maybe how much people talk about the gospel and how little they really understand it. I'm amazed that people that you would think they would understand the gospel, it's not that hard. And yet they don't seem to be very clear about it. And we want to talk about, especially I want to talk about some conclusions that I come to about the gospel. Let's read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also you are saved. We're saved by the gospel, by the message of the gospel. And so it says, if you keep in memory what I have preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. Now this is the gospel right here. How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. So that is the gospel. That's what we must give. Jesus said, go and teach all nations. You see, it's not a matter of just giving the gospel, just telling it. We need to teach it. We need to make sure people understand. A teacher has a great responsibility to impart his subject to his students. And if the students do not understand what the teacher is saying, whose fault is it? It's the teacher's fault. He needs to keep trying, find other ways to explain it. Now, if the student understands and doesn't obey, then that's his problem. But you see, in missions, we need to go and reach people in their languages and in their own culture so that they can understand what we're saying. And then if they reject the message of Christ, then that's their problem. But if they don't understand it, that's our problem. So maybe this morning, if you know the gospel and you love the gospel and you've believed it, maybe this will be a little bit of a review for you, because we need that from time to time, don't we, too? So that we remember what it is we're supposed to be telling people. And so this was Paul's passion to give the gospel to people. He said in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Make sure those two words are in your Bible, of Christ. Look at that verse, Romans 1:16. Maybe not right now, but later. If you have a Bible that doesn't have that, you're missing something. We'd suggest you get the Bible that we have, amen. But I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. So Christ has commanded us, go ye therefore and preach the gospel and to every creature. So we must understand the gospel because that message of the gospel is what saves us. Good things that we tell people are sometimes not really the gospel. For instance, we say, God loves you. That's true, that's good, but that's not all the gospel. I mean, we definitely need to tell people that. You are a sinner. Well, that's good. We need to tell people that. We need to understand that. But we haven't told them the gospel yet. We might say, you need to be saved. Well, that's true. And it's good. And we should tell people that. But we still haven't told them the gospel. We might say, okay, you need to pray. Say this prayer. We might even give them some words to help them to pray. But that's not the gospel. We need to do these things, say these things, but we need to give them the gospel. So what is the gospel? It's right there in verse 3 and 4. Let's look at it again. For I delivered unto you first of all. You got to get first things first, amen? You can't live the Christian life if you don't begin the Christian life. And so he said, first of all, that which also I received, he received it from God. And he said that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. Okay, that is the gospel. It's that Christ died for us in our place, that he was buried and he stayed dead for 3 days, and then he arose again and he's alive today. So it was Christ. And we need to understand who he is. You know, there's some false religions, and we don't have time to name them and tell why they're false, but sometimes they have what the Bible calls another Jesus and another gospel, which is not the real thing. You've got to make sure you don't have a counterfeit. So who is this Christ? Well, my Bible teaches me that he is God in the flesh. He came down. We think of this at Christmas time, but we ought to think about it every day of the year, that God came down in the form of a man. He was born of a virgin, and he lived a sinful life. And when he went to the cross, he was innocent. He wasn't like you and me. He was not a sinner. He was pure. He's the eternal Son of God. He didn't begin somewhere in history. He has always existed. And he's the creator. I could show you several verses where the Bible says that Jesus is the creator. He's God. And yet he's man at the same time. And so this is where we have to start, understanding who it is that went to the cross in our place. So the gospel also is according to the Scriptures. This is our authority. When we talk to people, it's not, well, the Bible Baptist Church believes this, or my religion believes, we teach this. No, it's thus saith the Lord. It's the Word of God. And that's important. And I want to know that. I want to know that what I'm trusting is God's Word, not the Word of some preacher, and not just some religion. And so it's according to the Scripture. And you see, this message is not complicated. It's very simple. Christ died for our sins. And I think we need to stop and think a little bit about what that word "for" is there for. It's he died for us. He died in our place. If I had a debt at the bank and you went to the bank and paid my debt, you would be doing that for me, in my place. And then I would be free from that debt. Thank God we're free from sin because Jesus paid the price of our sins. And then he rose again the third day. You know, the religions of the world, they don't have a risen Savior. They may have a lot of ceremonies and a lot of things, but they don't have a risen Savior. We do, thank God. And they can too if they will just turn to Christ. Amen. So we need to come to certain conclusions from this simple message. And I think we need to teach the gospel. We need to illustrate the gospel. We need to demonstrate it. We need to go back and teach it again until people really get it. And so the first conclusion that I come to is that my sin must be worse than I think it is. Because Jesus, the Son of God, had to die for my sins. My sins must be pretty bad. And yours aren't any better, amen? You know, you think about back in the beginning with Adam and Eve. And that's how we began. We went to the zoo on Friday and we really enjoyed that. And I saw some monkeys and some gorillas. But you know, they ain't my kinfolk. I'm sorry, but I don't care what they teach you in school. We didn't, I mean, like the guy said, some of my kinfolk might have hung by the neck, but they didn't hang by their tail, amen? So, but no, it began with Adam and Eve, just like the Bible says. And look at their sin. We'd say, well, that wasn't so bad. God gave them one rule, one commandment, don't eat the fruit of that tree, and they disobeyed. Adam didn't get drunk, he didn't beat his wife, he didn't commit adultery. There was no one else there. He didn't steal anything. He owned everything. He couldn't steal it from, he was the owner. But he disobeyed God, and that separated him from God. You see, When I look at the cross, when I look at what Jesus had to do for me, I realize that God is so very holy and we are so sinful that we just can't come to God. Something has to happen. There's some sacrifice that must be made to take away our sin so that we can be right with God, so we can be part of God's family. And this is the gospel. And so my sin is so bad it requires the death penalty. You know, we think, well, I've not killed anybody. I've not committed kidnapping or murder. I've never done anything really bad. It doesn't matter. The sin of Adam and Eve brought on the death penalty. And that's the way it is. We may not like it, but we have to go to the cemetery every once in a while, don't we? Isn't that sad? One day, praise God, we're not going to go there anymore. But, I might have thought, well, my good will outweigh my bad. A lot of people think that. That doesn't work that way. Or I might think, oh, all I need to do is, I just need to do my best. Well, people tell me that and they're not doing their best. They're lying when they tell me that. And so, I mean, what? Look at the cross. God says, your best isn't good enough. I've got to send my son to die because your good can't outweigh your bad, and you can't do enough good works. And some people say, well, I believe in God. Well, the Bible says that the devils, the demons, believe in God, and they tremble. Everybody believes in God. I think even atheists do. They just won't admit it. But so you believe there's a God in heaven. That's good. You need to start there. You need to admit that. But that doesn't make you his child, just acknowledging his presence. I believe that there's a president in Washington, and but I believe he's there, but I don't know him. I've never met him. And so that's the way it is with God. You may believe he's there, but you need to know him. Amen. You need to meet him. And or I might say, oh, I'm not as bad as some people are. You ever heard that before? Well, you don't compare yourself with other people. Compare yourself with Jesus Christ. How do you line up with him? Unless you're perfect like he is, you're condemned. And we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so I might say, well, I'm a sinner. I'm bad, but I'm not bad enough to go to hell. Well, how many sins do you have to commit to go to hell? Just one, amen. You're a sinner the first time you sin, and we've all sinned, and we've all been separated from God. Where else could we go? We can't go to heaven like we are. Something has to happen. And it happened, praise God, when Jesus went to the cross. Well, we can have all of our little excuses to try to justify ourselves, but we need to realize that our sin is worse than we thought it was. And then I also need to realize that my sin is so bad that it caused the death of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that he placed on him our sins. He that knew not sin was made sin for us. So whatever sin you and I have committed, Jesus took the guilt. He took the punishment from God that we deserve. Wow, that is absolutely amazing. Only God could come up with a plan like that. Man never does. Man believes in good works. Man says you do this, you pray this prayer, you say this, you do this, you sacrifice this, and you'll be all right. But God says, no, that won't work. So he says here in our text that Christ died for our sin. Can you put yourself there? Can you say, I am in that group that Paul was talking about when he said our sin? And it does include us all. So my sin is worse, far worse than I thought it was. And the second thing I conclude is that there must be no other alternative. Jesus went to the cross. You know, some people will say, well, yeah, that's okay, but there's a lot of ways to heaven. There's a lot of roads to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way. And so, you know, God owned everything. God owned the silver and the gold and the diamonds and all the wealth of the world, but that could not redeem us. The Apostle Peter says that we're not redeemed with corruptible things such as gold and silver from our vain conversation, but we're saved by the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without spot or blemish. God could not pay for our sins with his wealth. It would not work. God had angels and these heavenly beings like cherubim and seraphim, but he didn't send one of them. He had Michael the archangel, Gabriel, and then another one called Lucifer. And we know what happened to him. But he didn't send Michael to die for our sins. He sent his son to die. So another man could not die for us. I could not die for you because I'm a sinner. You could not die for me for the same reason. So there must be no other alternative. Now, you understand in the Old Testament, if you've read the Old Testament, there were certain animal sacrifices that they were supposed to offer at certain times. Goats and sheep and oxen or maybe even turtle doves, doves, but they shed all that blood. But the New Testament in Hebrews said that blood did not take away sin. It only covered it. It only only postponed the punishment. And it was intended to teach us that blood must be shed, yes, but that there would come one later who would shed his blood. And when John the Baptist one day was teaching the people, Jesus showed up and he pointed to Jesus and he said, "Behold the Lamb, the sacrificial Lamb, that taketh away the sin of the world." And every Jew that heard him understood what he was saying. They had been offering these lambs, but it wasn't really taking away their sins. But he said, "This is the Lamb of God." And so God knows everything. You cannot teach God anything because he already knows everything. If there were some other way for us to be saved, wouldn't God know of it? Would God send his Son to die and suffer on that cross if there was some other way? There is no other way. And God knows that. It would be an insult to God by me trusting in my good works. I say, "Well, I'm going to do these works and I'm going to help God save me." Or I'm going to save myself by what I do. What an insult to God. He sent his Son because he said, "You can't get there any other way. You can't get your sins forgiven any other way." You know, there are people, perhaps you've seen them. I've seen this on documentary films of people in the Philippines that will actually allow themselves to be crucified. Now, they don't die. They just hang there for a while on a cross, and they probably tie their arms. I doubt if they hang by those nails. But they're saying, "I'm going to suffer for my sins." And these are so-called Christian people. They're not Christian. They wouldn't do that if they were. They would know better. But our DVD, if you saw during Sunday school, there was one picture of some people, Mexican people, on their knees. I've seen it myself. And sometimes they will start from a long distance, maybe 1 or 2 kilometers away, on their knees, crawling across that rough stone all the way to the altar of that basilica. There's a picture or a cloth hanging up there on the wall. I've seen it. And it's a picture of the so-called Virgin of Guadalupe. They're not worshiping Jesus. They're worshiping that image. And they're thinking, "Okay, I'm going to get her favor because I'm hurting my knees." And don't you know that must hurt? I've tried to tell people, you don't need to do this. Jesus suffered for you. This won't take away your sins. They just keep going. It'll break your heart. But how do your works compare to those? Have you ever been crucified? Have you ever walked on your knees all that way? These people are doing what they think are good works, and it doesn't work. You know, the world says that the cross is foolish. But the cross says that the world is foolish. The cross is sending out a message this morning. And the world said, that's foolishness. That salvation by blood. That's just old-fashioned stuff. And we don't need that. We can do it ourselves. Well, one day they're going to find out when it's too late. So I have to conclude from the gospel that my sin is far worse than I thought it was. And I've got to conclude that there's no other way to be saved but by what Christ did for me. And the final thing is that I must conclude that God really loves me and wants me to be saved because he died for my sins. There's no gift that has ever been given like this gift. I mean, think about it. What more could God give than His Son? And oh, how He suffered. You know, we really can't explain it. We can't understand it fully. Jesus, we know what He suffered physically. We could have an idea of that. A medical doctor could explain the pain and the suffocation and the agony that a person would go through. Jesus was on the cross, I believe, for 6 hours. Sometimes people would stay on a cross like that for 2 or 3 days and suffer. It's a terrible suffering, but that's only a small part of it. Because when Christ took our sins, when God placed on Him our sins, He also gave Him the punishment, the separation, the agony, the thirst, the rejection that you and I deserve. That's why I say our sin is worse than we thought it was. And that's what Jesus suffered. You know, He wouldn't have done that if He didn't love you this morning. He loves you. You say, well, nobody ever loved me. Well, Jesus did when He went to that cross, and He does even now. So rejecting this gift, if I were to say, yeah, I understand all that, but I don't need it. I don't want it. Could you imagine any greater sin than rejecting the love of God, rejecting the blood of Christ, rejecting the suffering that Jesus went through for you? That I don't think murder or rape or bank robbery or any other sin could even come close to comparing to the sin of rejecting Jesus Christ. But sometimes people do. You're free to accept Him or to reject Him. But you just need to understand that there's no other alternative. There's no other way to be forgiven. So this is the gospel, and this is the hope that I have this morning, and it's the hope that you have, I trust. But if not, it can be. And this is the message that we're talking about in this conference. This is why we need missionaries. This is why we need to send them so that other people around the world can have this same privilege that we have. And I trust that you will get involved in giving to missions and praying for missionaries and even surrendering to go yourself. But if you have not trusted Jesus as your Savior, then this morning you need the gospel. That's all I have told you. I believe with all my heart, I have told you all that you need to know. It's up to you now to trust Jesus Christ and to receive Him. We're going to bow our heads, and I'm going to ask the pastor to come and conduct the invitation. Father, we pray right now that You would have Your way in each heart. And Lord, we just want to take a moment and thank You and praise You for loving us. Lord, only You could love us because we were so unlovely. And we thank You, Lord, for what You did to prove Your love when Jesus died in our place. Now, Lord, have Your way in this invitation, we pray. Lord, we would pray that every person this morning would respond in the correct way, and the way that would honor and thank You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just remain seated with your heads bowed, if you would, please. And as God speaks to our heart this morning, I wonder, with your heads bowed and as we just allow God to look at our heart, how many folks in the room would say, Pastor, I'm thankful that I understood the gospel one day, that Christ died for my sin, and that He wanted to save me, and I received Him as my Savior. Would you slip your hand up and say, I know that I'm saved this morning. I know that Jesus is my Savior. All right, you may put it down. Somebody here today would say, Pastor, I was never aware of that. This was new to me, and I realized that today that I was a sinner and that Christ died for my sins and that he took my place so I wouldn't have to be punished. And if I receive him as my Savior, you can receive the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. It doesn't get any simpler than that, and I'm glad God made it easy. Easy for our part, certainly not easy on his part. But if you're today and would say, Pastor, I don't have any assurance that if I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't know that I've ever understood what it means to be saved. Would you let me pray for you? I'm not going to embarrass you. We're not going to call you out, but I'll certainly pray for you. And you couldn't raise your hand the first time, but you just slip it up right now and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning. I'm not sure about my salvation, whether I'd go to heaven or not. Would you let me pray for you? Would you slip your hand up and then put it back down? God bless you. Thank you. Is there somebody else would say, Pastor, pray for me? All right. How many believers here today who, once again, we understand the gospel? You know, the songwriter wrote, I love to tell the story for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. When's the last time you told the gospel to somebody? When's the last time you told somebody about Jesus? Maybe the Lord has burdened your heart. Yes, this is missions and we're going to get the gospel to the ends of the earth, but we have a mission field right where we live, do we not? Aren't there people around us every day, every people we rub shoulders with and we pass in the stores that need to know about Jesus Christ? It's the last time you shared him with somebody. Wonder how many believers here today would say, I needed to hear the message today. I'm saved, but I needed to hear about the gospel again and the importance of getting people the gospel. Pastor, God spoke to my heart this morning. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, pray for me, Pastor. Yes. Amen. Wonderful. You may put them down. In a moment, I'm going to pray, and we'll have our invitation. This is an opportunity for those who the Lord has spoken to your heart for you to respond, and you come to the altar, and you bow before the Lord, and you do business with God. If you're here today, and you've never received Christ as your Savior, you've never really heard the gospel till you heard it explained this morning, then when others are coming to pray, would you slip from your seat and you come down to the front? I'll meet you. We have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll show you how you can know that you're on your way to heaven. They'll show you how you can not just know about heaven, but you can know you're going there. And take the time to come and let someone talk to you about how to know Jesus as your Savior. Whatever it is that God's dealing with your heart about, I want you to obey him this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for speaking to hearts. Thank you, Lord, for hands that have been uplifted this morning. And Lord, I pray now that each individual will do exactly what you're telling them to do in their heart, that no one would resist you today, but each would say yes to whatever it is you're dealing with them about. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you for the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ for us. Thank you for the great love that you have for us. And Lord, help us to care enough about Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for us that we'd want to tell others what he has done for them. So, Father, have your way in this invitation now, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet if you would, please. As you stand, the pianist will play. As Lisa plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. Lord has spoken to your heart this morning. Respond to him, will you?
Have thine own way.
That's right.
That's thou right. Thou art the potter, I am the clay.
Amen.
Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only always living in me.
All right, be seated for a minute if you would. Appreciate your attention today. And fellas, you get ready to collect our faith promise cards. Let me just talk to you about it for a minute. And again, this is a faith promise card for missions. This is what you'll give over and above what the tithe is. The tithe belongs to God, and you give that to Him. But over and above that, what you'll give to missions, either on a weekly or every other week or once a month or annually. Somebody may not say, well, I'm not going to give every week, but I've got some money that I have, and I'm just going to give a portion of that in a one-time gift, and that's okay too. But you ought to be involved in some way with getting the gospel out. Amen? Everybody ought to be involved in some way with getting the gospel out, and that's what this card does. There's no place to sign on it. There's nowhere. This is between you and God. No one's going to, we collect the cards, we add it up. That's how we get, when you see in the bulletin, the faith promise for the week is $690, what it was last year. That's what folks put on cards. It said they would give. And praise the Lord, we came out plus this year in the faith promise. And I think that's one of the first times that's happened in the 10 years. But it's been great. And folks really got behind that. And let's continue to do that. I expect that to go up this year. Good, four of us do. I expect that to go up this year, amen. And we ought to up our giving to God and up our faith in God each year, and just take another step to trusting Him, amen. And so it has a place there for the sower and the seed. The sower is the missionary. We have a place for the seed if you want to give some each week, and that goes directly to the printing of God's word. The seed is the word of God. And so, you know, it's one thing for a missionary to go to a place, but boy, if they don't have any Bible, they don't have any scripture, and it's a tough, how do you tell them about Jesus? You just take your word for it. And that's not what we want to do. The power is in the word of God. And so we want to make sure we're giving to get the word of God printed. That's the church's responsibility to do that. Your age group, and doesn't that put your age, just adult, teen, or a young person, okay? And just circle one of those, which you are. And then how often you'll give that amount. Will you give it every week? Will you give it monthly? Will you give it every other week, which is biweekly? Or are you going to give that? That's just a one-time gift, an annual gift. So you circle the correct one there, okay? And that'll help you. I hope you prayed about that. Brother Cobb showed you this on Thursday night and asked you to be praying about what the Lord would have you to do. I hope you've done that. And you can, if you haven't done that, I would encourage you not to put it in this morning, but to pray about that and put it in this evening and get the mind of God on the matter. We all have a tendency to walk by sight and not by faith. And so we will kind of do what we think we can do instead of doing what we believe that God may want us to do. And so I want us to do what God wants, and it'll take care of our need. That we have, but we want to get the gospel out. I don't know about you, well, in Sunday school, in that DVD that he showed for BBTI, 7,000 languages in the world, and there's 3,000 of them that have no Bible, have never heard of Jesus Christ. That's just unbelievable. And shame on us. Shame on us. I think there's a scripture that says, some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. And boy, shame on us. We have the resources in America. to get the job done. We really do. We just have to be willing to turn them loose. And God has blessed us. Let's pass it on and get the gospel out. Okay, fellas, you come. And we'll get ready to collect our cards for this morning. And then, of course, we'll collect them again this evening as well. All right. Father, we thank you for the privilege that's ours to give to missions. Thank you, Lord, for a church that loves missionaries and loves to get the gospel out to the ends of the earth. You've done some wonderful things through the years through Faith Promise Missions here at Bible Baptist Church. And, Lord, I pray that you'll do some great things this coming year. So, Lord, I pray that folks have sought your face and sought your will in the matter as far as what we should give, believing that you'll provide for our needs, Lord. We want to do exactly what you want us to do, and we want to have a further reach with the gospel. And so, Lord, bless the giving that's done, and, Lord, provide for people who are stepping out by faith, and we'll thank you for it. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, brother, by the way, the missionaries have displays in the conference room. If you haven't been down in there yet to see the displays, I invite you to get in there after service this morning, and you'll enjoy seeing the displays. Pick up a prayer card and use it. Pray for these folks. And I'm going to ask Brother and Mrs. Cobb, if they would, when we pray, if you'll just go to the back door there and folks can greet you as they go out this morning. That's usually where my wife and I are. We'll let you take our place this morning, all right? And that way folks can tell you how they enjoyed the message this morning, all right? And these are wonderful folks, and just a great time. Don't miss tonight now as we have our final service and we have to say goodbye to our missionaries, and just a great time. So don't miss that. If you normally don't come on Sunday night, make an exception and come tonight, okay? You don't want to miss this service, okay? Let's stand together. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, again for the wonderful gospel message. And Father, thank you again for the great love you have for us. And remind us again, God, the great sacrifice that was given that we might have eternal life. Lord, may your love constrain us to tell others about Jesus today. Lord, dismiss us from this place with your care. And Father, make us mindful you go with us from this place this morning. Lord, give us a good afternoon, and then prepare us to come back tonight and what you have for us in our final service of the conference this evening. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing, "I'm So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God." Let's sing that together, shall we?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joint heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.